and also into this treatment chamber that's currently there. So.
So I guess we are requesting a negative determination.
So this last page on the last two pages on the application were from the initial application back in 2007?
Yeah, from the initial, I don't know.
When was the certificate of compliance? I don't know.
So because it was completed, the construction area was completed in 2008, so it had to be 4 years later.
So where is my picture going to appear?
Right, they haven't had any drainage issues thus far. So. From what I understand, I believe the stormwater system was designed to accommodate this as paved anyways.
Mm-hmm.
But then when they came to the commission requested they use low impact development as much as they could. So then that's when they decided to use the grass pavers and to make a rain garden and to make the vegetated soil. So it was, yeah. Just, I think they originally probably wanted to pave it, but then it was requested that they use as much, or as many LIDs as possible. That's from my understanding, just reading the NOI and the drainage calculation. So,
I read through this a few days ago. It seems that the statement in the current application was that the system was designed without needing the current area with the grass pavers to actually be pervious. But then when I read the background document, calculation, design, and standards. The proposed stormwater management system has been designed to incorporate natural drainage patterns, one hydrant dam separator, one infiltration chamber system, and pervious pavement. I just wasn't sure what the pervious pavement referred to. It refers to the thing we're now going to approve for pavement, and then is a mountain. So.
Where is that? From the
that's
from
the stormwater drainage analysis is attached to from this is from March 2007, so it's from the middle of that.
Oh, it's from the initial. I don't know. Oh, okay.
No.
Now that it's disturbed, then we're allowing it to be safe. And I mean, like, allowed for impervious surfaces, but now our wetland ordinance says that if there's a disturbed area, we can disturb it again, and that's what's kind of happening.
In this case, it's a little bit different because the curb number was requested initially. This was just a mention.
They were trying, and that's what I want to know is, what, how was it considered in the previous, previous proposal? Was it actually impervious? Why did they even decide to?
I think we were really hoping to be able to move it level for the quality of the but it was
we have to use the plastic ones because we have some at our office that are cement, with grass in between that. They work really nicely. But I don't know what this site, even if you were to put those, I don't think the soils are good for infiltrating anyway. So even if you install the new rivers that seem to work better, I don't know if it would work. Pictures, it just looks like it gets piled up behind the parking area.
Which is actually a drainage field.
In this.
On the other side of that.
Of the concrete.
Concrete barrier. It's not going to get plowed in the corner of the parking lot. They're not allowed to plow it under the wetland. Push it out down to the corner of the parking lot. Which you don't see. looking for in the 2007 application is whether there's anything that clearly states that the square footage that grass pavers was not assumed to be pervious for purposes of the stormwater plan. And how do you know that? I just if you were sort of looking for it.
Yeah, I had a hard time finding that too, and that it was in the full drainage calculations.
The only thing that would make me think that that's the case is that each end of that grass paved area, elements of a stormwater management treatment chamber, or the culvert itself, if those were assumed to be permanent, we would have those elements of the stormwater system to go in. But I was looking for more than that. So then it seems like this is not an additional alteration for resource purposes. If not, then maybe we got to ask to go back and come back to this with this calculation.
You have the whole stormwater analysis structure. Yeah, that's fine. I have a copy of my. I have a hard time with it right now. Where it said that it's on
the table. So, in the absence of that, I think my equation will continue to do it. And I can infer from the fact that in the engineering plans, there are elements of the stormwater management system surrounding this, so it probably was not intended to refer to it, but that does not necessarily mean that the calculations for sizing the system for this additional area. This area that would be additional.
I don't think they have a coefficient for grass pavers, though. I'm not sure that even exists, but I'm not 100%.
So they would have had to assume it to be paid?
Exactly.
The only thing I can add is that it's not included in the best practice on the stormwater checklist, but I didn't find it.
I don't have any indication that the certificate of compliance is not listed, but probably it's all done properly. Are we changing something which is assumed to be impervious? Or are we leaving something in a different form of impervious? There's always this. Yeah. Then it's straightforward. I feel comfortable saying that's well, we're asking.
I wondered if we had that. Or I would also be okay if within the conditions, it said that we, that there was some discussion about Conservation Commission requiring that they should put this, the best model, but then if we suggested to do it, then.
But it wasn't part of the stormwater calculations, it was just a nice step.
Right, yeah, otherwise it may have been, it would have been assumed, I would be okay with that, because it probably assumed to pay both Conservation Commission one and then try out something that provides. So if that were also, find that out.
The only really specific conditions in the order were regarding the water quality going on in the street, but nothing to.
What was that?
Something of the conditions, or something about food in the parking lot, and something about the swale.
Inspecting the swale, I see it.
So, you said you had, did you say you had the most cross college reported?
Yeah, I have it, I just don't have it.
So I guess we're requesting the applicant to, remove the environmental impact with the, conservation, stormwater calculation. Assuming that that area that is, that the grass papers is assumed to be impervious, then we can proceed to the board to request.
So would you want hard copies of that document, or mail, or?
I guess we need a verification, I'm not assuming the New England Environmental has to redo the stormwater, she said, I'll be out there, but to find those that were done by Berkshire Design, and verify that, in fact, the area we're talking about taking out was always assumed to be impervious, and we can proceed with the case, but in fact, my recommendation is to continue it for all. Continue the hearing, probably get that information.
Okay. Maybe I have to get a letter from Berkshire.
Yeah.
Because they did the stormwater analysis.
Is that the license is extended for that, right, yes, that's right, yeah.
Okay.
So motion to continue?
Yes.
So what's our other people?
August.
I'll tell you later.
August 10th. And you first up? 5:00.
Okay.
You have another question?
I'm not so sure, so why are you, of course, the cost of.
A larger what?
Forest. It's a nine space, but they cross the drive, larger area, according to the legislation. Or forest park, which is still forest park.
That's the one I just left there.
Yeah, I think that's the 19. Yeah, that's where the 19 spaces. So, motion to continue to the 9th at 5:00? 7:00?
6:00.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thanks.
Thanks.
We'll see you then.
Yep.
Next item. Here is. Request for the decision about the current, and the parking area and lighting, the construction of the drop-off lane and the riding plaza subject to wetland protection act with Northampton wetlands ordinance. Site is at Northampton Montessori School, 51 Bay Street.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Peter Wells. I'm with the Berkshire Design Group. This is a request for determination for a project that we're involved with Montessori School in Northampton. And I brought a rendered site plan for your review that we can better delineate where buildings are and so forth. Industrial Drive and off of Bates Street. Existing Montessori School, existing parking. This is the bike path located to the south of our project. There's a small isolated wetland within the bike path area, quite thick in terms of vegetation. It's about 6 feet below grade from the adjacent ground. I've shown the 100-foot buffer. A small portion of our proposed project falls within the 100-foot buffer. And the project basically consists of removing a drop-off area, which is somewhat congested, and gaining permission and approval to provide a drop-off lane along Industrial Drive for safer, easier drop-off during morning and afternoon times. Along with that, we're going to probably end up reconfiguring the pedestrian circulation system going into the school, but very limited in terms of the amount of disturbance. The site now drains away from our work area down in Industrial Drive, not toward the wetland areas. So this portion right here is the area that is within your jurisdiction that we plan on removing, putting planting in there, increasing the parking by two spaces, and then creating a drop-off lane over here. We thought submitting a request for determination at this early stage would be helpful for us in terms of planning. We're not even sure if we're going to get permission to actually create a drop-off lane along Industrial. We have to talk to DPW. Basically, this is an amended site plan that they have in case now. For those of you that, this is a quick concept showing what the drop-off lane would look like, along with reoriented and creating more of a pedestrian space in front of the school versus a drop-off lane. And this is just a quick concept. I haven't even passed this along through committee yet, but it just shows you roughly the amount of work that's going to occur within the buffer zone. So with that, I'll open up to any questions you might have. Overall, we're getting rid of this amount of impervious. We're going to keep this amount here, and we're going to add some over to Industrial Drive. Within your jurisdiction, it's probably the same amount of impervious. It's very close. In fact, with the proposed design, I would say it's extremely close. We are adding another tree and tree well, along with planting along Industrial Drive. I'm sorry, it's hard to hear with the...
We really don't know what's the final design.
That's the most.
Okay.
Other questions for the group? Checking box three, indicate that it's within the buffer zone, but will not alter an area subject to protection.
It might also suggest a condition that the commission doesn't see the problem. It's just to make sure that the purpose area is increased.
Okay, any comments, questions from the public?
Close.
So we'll second it on favor.
Aye.
Vote. So voted.
Thank you.
Motion.
I move the commission to step up six and state that the working on the plan three. Issue a negative determination to step up three. That the proposed board will not alter the subject area. But there are two conditions. One, requiring that no more impervious surface. To the people, the impervious surface is equal to a less than 10 conditions. And that the conditions should be presented with a final plan before the
right. Do we want the final plan to come to the commission or to staff?
Yeah.
For a second. Discussion, just for clarification, Sarah, the reason that the Department's Act, that the state rule doesn't apply is because it's an isolated one. I'll give you a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So moved.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I've got about six in the car.
Next item. Management plan for the Meadows Conservation Area Library Section. Hi, everyone. I think we've all received the plan yesterday, and had a chance to read it. Anybody want to summarize the highlights or add anything to it?
I would just like, I'm Jane Potter, I'm the president of the Meadow City Conservation Coalition. I just wanted to let you know some of the, and can you hear me? Because I know we
can't hear you.
Okay. This plan came about in consultation with Broadbrook and is basically completely based on their management plan for Fitzgerald Lake, just so you know. And we've met with Wayne and Sarah, I think your comments were interpreted as well, but just so that you know, Wayne is in agreement with this plan. I think he gave it to you with his approval.
Yeah, he forwarded us a good deal with his comments.
Okay. So, if you would like me to summarize it, I'm happy to do that. I think I don't probably need to summarize the history, which is kind of long. We do, by the way, have, as I think you guys asked for, the historical record. So, I'm happy to. Is this the? Okay. So here you go. The tome of document. So the plan. We're considering the following resources in this plan, which are in concert with the intent of the conservation restriction, which is provisionally in effect on the land, which includes a finger wetland, a small playing field, and a tall grass meadow. And it also includes the native shrubs and the trees that are around the perimeter of the Montview parcel. So those are the resources we're starting with. Our goals are to basically conserve. We want to conserve a portion of the Connecticut River floodplain, which is, as you probably know, those of you who have been on the land, now isolated from the river by a flood control dike. And this provides some flood storage in the event of a localized flood. We want to conserve the rich alluvial floodplain soils. This is some of the finest soil anywhere to be found. We want to preserve the outdoor passive recreation opportunities for the public, including walking trails and a mowed, grassy, open, multi-purpose space for community activities and child play. We want to preserve the open space viewshed at one of the densest urban neighborhoods in the city of Northampton, consistent with the city's goals of encouraging infill in urban areas of the city in conjunction with local parks and open spaces in areas for recreation and enjoyment. We want to retain a portion of this land as tall grass meadow. It serves as an important habitat for wildlife of various types, and it retains the open space viewshed that gave the name to Montview Avenue itself. And so the plan for doing this restoration and maintenance, actually, for the finger wetland involves removing the existing footbridge, monitoring the area for invasives and removal of invasives as necessary, and an annual assessment of the health of the wetland. A lot of this was based on Downing Meyer's good suggestions to us, and Sarah's as well. Area B is the public playing field. This was established the very first year that the city owned the parcel and has attracted many forms of passive recreation. Neighbors have taken care of this field, have kept it mowed every summer, and our goal is to continue to maintain it and to manage it by regular mowing and treatment of the grassy area with lime and organic fertilizer. And the other piece of the land is the tall grass meadow. And we want to maintain the openness of this small parcel that welcomes potential use. And we also want to discourage illegal littering and dumping, which it happens a lot in the meadow area. We've been trying to help keep it under control, but it's a big problem. We'd like to maintain the walking trail just to minimize damage to some of the sensitive areas. And at some point, we'd like to create a self-guided interpretive trail for people to take advantage of. And it's worthy of note that the city has an interest in keeping clear passage here just because large equipment may need to come through when the stormwater line in the bed of the old William Street Brook might need maintenance or even replacement. There's an active cage patch basin on this line, as you may know. And we feel that tall grass meadow is a wonderful alternative to a floodplain forest in an area where the forest can't really be reestablished because of the dike that prevents the river from coming through every spring. So to attend to those goals for the tall grass meadow, we recommend annual mowing at the end of the summer after the ground nesting birds and animals have ceased caring for their young. We recommend vigilant attention to removing invasive species, especially including multiflora rose, bittersweet, and garlic mustard. And we hope to do that with the advice of the conservation committee so we don't make any mistakes on that account. And we hope to enrich the area with 20% of the area becoming native woody plants just to maximize the extent and the value of animal habitat. So those are the key points. like to do with the forest garden is to keep as much of it as makes sense, the more mature plantings. But we haven't had time to do this because we had to put this together so quickly. But what I've discussed with Wayne is that we'd like very much to work in consultation with Grow Food Northampton and see if some of the smaller plantings could be moved to a space where they could grow and the forest garden could become a much bigger showpiece for the city and for the community than it can be in this small parcel.
But in answer to Nathan's question, to preserve some of those plants but not all?
The smaller ones that can be safely transported, we would like to have them be in a forest garden that could be bigger and that could go on in perpetuity without much maintenance.
But we have not had a full discussion of this. We really concentrated on the management plan and also focused on the fact that the parcel needs to be returned to its condition in 2005. So where the compromises are between that restoration and maintaining some of the forest garden plantings hasn't been worked out.
Do you have diagrams in what? No, because this was put together separately.
But it's easy to diagram. Okay. Area A is the wetland and the buffer. Area B.
Referring to the original
not
drawing that was
given? No. We've renumbered or re-lettered the areas.
Sarah has a copy.
Okay. So area.
No, it's the old one, Sarah. I don't know if you would have kept it from one of the other PowerPoint presentations,
but
if I remember correctly.
You guys all know this at this point, the different areas. Area A is the finger wetland.
I know the one that's down through. That's the one I have.
The new areas A, B, and C are as follows. Area A, the finger wetland, and the border. The buffer. The buffer. Area B, the playing field, and area C, everything else.
It would make sense to
have improved. We had one, just didn't have the technical facility to transmit it back and forth. So if there's a conceptual agreement about this, we can, I noticed there's some typos as well. We can produce a cleaned up copy with the map, with the sections.
It just makes sense.
Of course. Yeah.
Right. No, we'd be happy to do this. What you may recall that we had about 10 days to put this together. So this is a
pretty good document.
It's a pretty good document for that amount of time. But whatever inclusions you would find helpful for the record, we're happy to provide.
And we think our best source of maps is probably Sarah, but in the negotiations with OPD, there wasn't really time to get the map.
Oh, is there a survey?
Okay.
Those of us who did the final copy were technically inept.
What happened to the map for some?
It didn't end up getting printed.
Other questions from the commission?
And we didn't have a screen.
Comments or questions from the public?
Yes. I can't do the meeting tonight after missing. My name is Adele Franks. I live in Florence. I missed the last couple meetings, so I'm not totally up on what's been happening. But I saw that the management was on the agenda. And I feel very strongly that the forest garden is intended to be a treasure for the neighborhood as well as the city. And so I came here to voice my strong support for maintaining it very effectively. And my impression from the last meeting that I had attended was that Downey's and if cultivated, or rather allowed to dry over time, the shrubs and trees will mature and produce even more bountiful fruits for people to enjoy. And last week I went to the Tuesday market and got to enjoy some shaved ice with red currant syrup on it from my family. It's very sweet. So I would think it would be a terrible loss to not maintain the forest garden and allow it to achieve its full potential.
Other comments? Yes.
My name is Sigrid Schmalzer. I live at 102 William Street. I love the conservation lands. I have to say I've been on pins and needles because I've been wondering what the plan was going to be, and I haven't heard anything about it until I came here today. And I have to say a lot of it just sounds great. Very much in concert with the idea of protecting the public access and making conservation really at the core. I mean, this is all great, and I'm also really relieved and excited to hear that M3C is also interested in preserving the forest garden to some extent. And but my only concern really is with the, and I understand that it's only been 10 days, so unable to, they're unable to specifically, exactly, but my thoughts would be to preserve it really as much as possible. So I can definitely speak to how much the forest garden is treasured by children in the neighborhood. My son helped plant some of those plantings with Paige, and he and other friends. My son is 4 years old, so that's actually a big deal for him to know that he's had that connection to the land. And he and his other friends have really enjoyed in past years picking husk cherries. There was 1 year where the husk cherries were just incredible. And this year, the currants and the Nanking cherries were extraordinary. You can see the pears and the plums just ripening. It's just thrilling. It's a magical, magical place for me, not to mention for my four-year-old and for other children in the neighborhood. It is just such a special, special place, and I definitely see the idea, that we want, people to know about that. But I think that Berkeley, Northampton could probably, also find some. They're not such rare plantings that other places couldn't also find. I personally would favor keeping as many of them possible, right there where they are, that would be my really strong hope that could be maintained. It's not a very big part of the overall parcel, and so the idea, I think, they can coexist very, very beautifully. The meadows and this forest garden portion of it. The other thing I wanted to ask is does the history include all of those minutes from all of the meetings last year as well? Just interesting, that tome that you guys produced.
I think all the materials are in there.
Okay.
I know you've been in very many meetings. I think most of them are there.
Okay, great. Yeah, I mean, if that, this stuff, but I think I gave them all to Tim Marcy, so I don't know if those, Marcy made those.
Excuse me, can I speak to that issue? Over the last two or three meetings of CONSCOM, one of the issues that's come up repeatedly is exactly what constitutes the forest garden. And we noticed last time that the definition is very fuzzy. And I think before this issue can be finally solved, we can't do it in the abstract. We need an inventory, and so far no inventory has been made. Some of the plantings are vigorous enough so they can sustain themselves without agricultural intervention, and some are not. And those are some of the questions that have to be sorted out that are very practical. They can't be sorted out in an abstract way, and that's why the management plan doesn't address
that issue in detail.
There's another question that comes to my mind, and it seems to me that preserving the forest garden is sort of problematic from a legal point of view and from a procedural point of view, because actually what happened is the forest garden was put in place during a farming lease, which terminated. And then those plants became property of the city. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So if you preserve that in perpetuity, or forever, however long, basically what you're saying is I can get a lease to farm some conservation land. In the course of doing that, I could plant 6 apple trees. The lease is terminated, but then I could ask you to have those apple trees remain there, and I could have an apple orchard. I mean, that doesn't seem kosher to me. It sounds like if you preserve the forest garden, you're going to set a precedence that could be carried on in the future.
Just to be clear, the commission said, since we have inherited certain perennial plants by terms of the expired lease, let's at least until other decisions are made not destroy them.
Yeah.
It isn't the same as preserving them. Nobody's ever said anything about preserving them.
Yeah.
We just said that until we make other decisions, which are going to be involved with who's going to manage the land, that's not.
So you're not going to set a precedent?
Preserve. We wanted to, if they needed attention in order to survive, we wanted to have the minimum amount of attention necessary until other decisions are made. That's all we've done.
Okay, so you're not going to set a precedent?
But the commission, whether something is agriculturally used or not, is not all that important to the commission. Our mandate is conservation, and it is a portion of it happens to have a value system. There's communicated to us was that there's some habitat and nutritional value to small animals, birds and so forth, why this, but that's not the only way we're achieving wild spaces and all kinds of so it's, this may be a great thing agriculturally. That's not our mandate or our purview. We don't necessarily want to do away with it, but we don't necessarily want to be in the business of preserving it. It was just, since we inherited the plants, we didn't want to foreclose the option of doing something with some of the plants later on. And that's what this discussion is. Okay?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that we think the forest garden is a beautiful thing, too. I'm delighted that so many people have been able to enjoy it. I think the whole point here is that since there are a number of small saplings there, some of the ways that you've tried to increase it in wonderful ways, that we think the forest garden could have a bigger home and be in perpetuity in a larger physical land. It would have the opportunity to really, you know, double, triple, whatever the size you want it to be. And it doesn't have that opportunity in the small
person. I'm Gene Nashley, Vermont. The reason I support this management plan is it gets us back towards the original conditions of the property prior to it being leased. That there are some plants that have some value on the property, and we don't want to destroy them. We would like to see ways that they could be, maybe there's something that could be transferred, could be used elsewhere in the city. Maybe a neighbor or two would like to take them onto their property. I don't know. But what's important to me is that we get back to the original vision for what that property was and not be managing it in the way that people who lease the property would like to see it managed. And furthermore, the reason we'd like to do that is because as one of the people who cares provide service on their property, it's very complicated once you start to get putting different ecosystems in there. We already have to manage a wetland and a buffer, and we have a green space which the neighbors use. To start complicating it with things that were left there by leaseholders, there's value there, and I think we need to honor that. But
but I do take issue with the concept of a forest garden. There are definitely trees and shrubs and plants with value, and I want to honor that. But to call this some sort of ecosystem, I there's a wetland there. I agree with that. But calling it a forest garden, I don't know what that is. But I think we can honor the valuing those plants and taking care of them. And, you know, some, if it's so well rooted that it's got to stay, it's got to stay. But if it can be moved, why is it? That's why I support this plan. So,
sure. Yeah, and it's sort of prohibitive over there.
If you name
it, it's not very. Oh, I'm sorry, Rick Clark, 84 Lamb Street. So that sectioned off area of the land has been uninvited by its design. So there's also, I've done some research on permaculture, and the fact is that some species may have been introduced to that area of land that are not known to us, that may very well be non-native or invasive species. We have no inventory of anything that's been planted over there. There's been no documentation of it. So I'm concerned about that parcel being segmented off from the rest of conservation and divided.
I just want to add one more thing. I know that it's been put forth that children enjoy the area. My kids have grown up next to this project, and while they didn't have a sense of come over here and pick our stuff, I mean, that didn't go on. There was times where things were offered to us in a neighborly fashion. We offered water, we allowed a shed to be stored on our property. Things were excess produce were provided to us. That was great, but we operated as neighbors, but there was no idea of, like, come over and just pick whatever you want, kids. And I don't think any of the kids in the neighborhood felt they could go over there and take things out of what was on public property. So, you know, I take issue with that, the concept that it's, you know, it's for the kids, you know.
Can I clarify there? Because, you know, certainly my son had a special relationship. I guess I'm not saying that the future is exactly the same as the past. I'm saying that what my son was fortunate enough to experience and what I know his friends were also fortunate enough to experience could potentially be something that, you know, in this new model where it's no longer being farmed, right, for a farming purpose by leaseholders, but rather in this new model, that could be something that more kids could enjoy. So I didn't mean to imply to Jim that was something that the future was, you know, was the same as the past. I'm just trying to speak to my son's experience and say that I know that for children it is a magical experience, and it would be my hope that could be preserved. And now that it's no longer being farmed by the leaseholders, but rather, you know, this other model, that there's no reason why this couldn't be something that everybody could enjoy as individuals.
Yeah, I would just like to say that I don't know that we really have disagreement here. I think what I would love to see, since we've gotten this far, is for you to hopefully accept the management plan as is, and then we could work with various parties to come up with both an inventory and a solution to that particular section of the land, which would let us move forward a little bit.
I guess I want to ask of the commissioners sense of where we've gotten to in the few months that we've been talking about this project is that we've identified MC3 as the group that we're working with to develop a responsibility for day-to-day management, and that within the expense of this recognition that this is conservation. Essentially them proposed to us guidelines as they are, then unless they run afoul of some of our responsibilities, we would agree, essentially, that this is something that easily was intended at the beginning to be disproportionately influenced by the way they live. The neighbors have been inviting of others, of course, that doesn't mean that they're going to get a lot into no public process is open. My question to the commissioners is, does anybody have you gone from a fairly contentious beginning without talking about what to do with certain plants? That seems to me to be great progress, and it's a good. I don't really want to be talking about what to do with a plan that doesn't have to do with it. I think the overall approach is to be important, but I want to check with Commissioner Powers to see if there is. But is anybody really invested in any particular position vis-a-vis the fruit bearing plants or the plant that you can do?
Sorry, I'm not interested.
What did you say?
I'm more interested in the weapons.
But I have this question about process. This is an idea.
This isn't really a hearing, so it's a discussion.
It's a discussion. And then when you make the decision, I think about green to the member.
I think
Tim,
this is.
I will. I was directing it toward that.
Can we turn this off?
Sure. Yeah, my question is a point of process, and it was to them asking, anyone in the of when do we vote as a commission on the MOU, and what state do we want it to be in?
Yeah, my understanding is that this is a first review of a written plan, and that if there's agreement in concept and feedback with specific recommendations, that then it will come back and we will actually vote on it at a later meeting. But Wayne,
yes, there's actually three documents being approved. This is the first of three. So this is the management plan. You can approve it now or approve it with the final changes. Assuming you approve this, I think the next document is the MOU. MOU could be an appendix to this or it could be a freestanding document. It doesn't matter. But this, so the MOU, like for Broad Coalition, it says specifically, here's the things that they can do in accordance with the management plan without coming back to the Conservation Commission. Here's the things they have to come back to the Conservation Commission for. So we'd have to spell those things out. It made sense to make sure that everyone's on the same page, ignoring some minor plan issues, about the management plan before we got into drafting. And again, using BBC as the model, which is what they're suggesting, they're separate documents. They could be the same documents. There's no magic there. And then at some point, hopefully not too distant future, is the third document, which you guys have already directed us to go forward on, to the conservation restriction itself, which they've agreed to.
Thanks.
So
my own sense is to the commissioners that this is a pretty sound plan. I was actually impressed that it was developed since our last meeting on the subject. It was pretty thorough. But that I would like to see, as we often do, as we did in an earlier case tonight, we want to see the plan and some visual representation. And we understand descriptively what the approaches are to the different areas, but to have a picture would be a good addition. But other than that, I'm inclined to say that the MC3 folks are people we're working with, have responsibility for day-to-day management. They've indicated that in terms of the perennials and fruit-bearing plants on the property, they intend to retain some and not all, and that seems to be fine to me. I don't have a spec from a... One of my kids is a farmer. If I wear a different hat, I might want to see certain kinds of things, but from the Conservation Commission had, I think it's as long as your plan does not violate anything for which we have responsibility, it's your call.
I have a proposal in terms of process.
Yes.
If you take a recess for 5 minutes and Sarah prints us out a map, we can draw A, B, C and hand it around to you so that we might be able to finish this stage of the three document process tonight if people are comfortable.
Well, I think that we've, I think we're prepared to say that this is in principle, this is a good document, and that as we proceed to the next step, we will want to see a more specific demarcation of the areas that these later management plans actually talk about.
Sure.
Exactly. I wasn't expecting a plan, you know, a diagram tonight. You've seen enough diagrams to be pretty familiar with the area, and at least I know where the wetlands are.
Excuse me. We have a diagram.
Right. But you don't need the diagram for tonight. The description's fine. It's just that in the final management plan, the diagram. That was my only point. Necessarily need to see one.
But you're essentially saying that C is all other, as opposed to the Downey's, where it's broken down into D
a little bit more.
Well, Kevin, if I don't mean to interrupt the process, but if I understand you correctly, if you are able to provisionally approve this tonight, we can happily organize the visuals and the maps, and in a couple of days get you a final draft.
So.
Yeah, I agree. I would like this. I mean, I don't need anything more detailed right at this point. I think it's a great plan. You've gotten a really good job of putting this together.
Thank you.
But I would like to see more details. I mean, the management plan to me is everything from the objectives down, you know, not including the history.
Right.
And I think it's pretty good. But when you get to the specifics of implementation, it would be good to have some more details for me. And that's just going to come out as in the process of figuring out what are the plans that you keep. Oh, what are the invasives that you want to remove or not remove? How are you? I mean, those are the kinds of things that I'd like to.
And then each time, if you're going to go into the wetlands to remove anything, then you got to come and talk to us.
Right.
But I have a question about process.
Yes.
It's sort of like chicken and egg. If you don't approve something and give us authority to do this, then we can't do anything, we can't exactly figure out the details until we begin to do something.
The Broadbrook plan, for instance, has a pretty, the details are not maybe as specific as you would like, which is, you know, we can do it any way you want, but pretty specifically details with Conservation Commission approval.
Mm-hmm.
So that anything that we do, we need to at least check, if not with you as a committee, with Sarah and Wayne or with OPD to make sure we know what we're doing with invasives.
Right. I mean, that's the level of detail that would have to be added.
Okay.
I think what we're saying, Maria, is that as an overall design and in principle, this is good. And that in order to be something that we actually sign on to, it'll need that level of specificity so that the list of if you're going to do this, you have to ask us. If you do this, you have to ask Sarah. And if you do this, you only have to decide it for yourselves. But that and to which areas those apply.
That's fine.
That level of specificity is what's missing. But other than that, this is good to go.
Well, to that point, Marcy Clark, 84 Wayne Street. To that point, and kind of echoing what Wayne just mentioned, and what we learned from Broadbrook is that's what appears in the MOU. So that's kind of what we were expecting, that level of specificity to be in the MOU as our 3-year, you know, working to-do list, basically.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that was our understanding, and again, kind of, as if I heard Wayne correctly, I think that's what he was saying as well.
So,
this is kind of our vision, and then
we went around and we did the management plan first based on what we were asked to do, and the MOU and the CR will follow with more detail.
And I think, let me ask Sarah and Wayne for an opinion. Does this require a distinct vote, or is it merely a sense of the meeting that, yep, this is what we had in mind, needs a little detail behind it, but we can actually vote when it comes time for the MOU.
Yeah, I don't think it really matters. You know, you would refer, the MOU would refer to this, whether you have a separate vote on this or just do this part of the MOU, that's up to you.
So,
I think it would help us if you voted one way or another, so it acts as a kind of ratchet and we don't go backward.
So that you have, yes, I mean, we will expect in whatever the next iteration is that this is not substantially changed. So that, from that perspective, I'd be happy to entertain a motion that we affirm that this document as presented, while not yet complete in the level of detail, is in fact what we're comfortable with and expect to use as a basis to go forward.
I think one thing that the commission should note, though, just to throw out there, that this plan urges that the buffer around the wetlands be defined as 20 feet, which is fine if that's what the commission decides, but just to note
that. No, I noted that. It's a pretty compressed area, so I wouldn't especially worry about it. What do you think?
It was essentially there when I first saw the property. And it's now overgrown. Yeah, essentially there was a walkway or a cleared way around the initial wetlands.
Right.
Something and 20 feet's totally to you. I'm personally comfortable with 20 feet. The only thing that makes me nervous at 20 feet is when you have a big buffer in a conservation area, we tend not to be incredibly accurate at mapping the wetlands. If you only have a 20-foot buffer, it just means you really need to know where the wetlands is.
And I didn't... did you flag it or did Downing flag it?
Downing.
What's your confidence level?
Downing was stomping out garlic mustard while I was hanging for legs.
And this plan notes also correctly that permits would be required for any work there in any case.
Anybody have problems with the 20 feet?
I don't have a problem with 20 feet. Having seen it in its initial stage.
In this case, it seems it's such a small area and it's been used like that in the past.
It's actually a remnant.
Right.
Jim? CONSCOM in the past approved the 20 foot. And that's why we've been operating that way. The other thing is that the only thing that we're planning to do within, is to, it has to do with the path. We're not building structures. We're not, we want it to be a nature. So you don't have to worry about
the only person
a parking garage going
here
over
here who saw it before and knows about the 20 feet is in favor of it.
So,
well, I'm saying you're right twice.
So I'd be happy to entertain a motion to affirm the opinion of the board. So it's not a full acceptance because the document isn't completed yet, but it's an affirmation that in fact what's been presented to us is a good basis for proceeding to the next step.
So moved.
Can I just make? I just have a couple, just minor questions, and I think as much as possible. Like I had made a comment a couple of weeks ago about this. This is you're planning to maintain a meadow, which is good, but I think that should be very clear. I mean, there's a one point in the management and goals objectives in E. It says retention of the land as a tall grass meadow, and I would use the wording maintenance. Or actively maintaining this as a meadow, just because I think it's important for us to know that we are intentionally maintaining this as a meadow.
Okay.
And that's fine. I mean, it's conservation is about what we want, and our values here, your values here, are that you value a meadow for a lot of different reasons, and you'll have to work at that. So in any case, I'd like to, in any part of it, that if you could make that really clear, it's a fine management goal. And related to that, then, I'd like to see a little more kind of thought, and this is where the specifics come in, about what are the invasives you want to remove so that you can maintain that meadow. It's connected to that. If your conservation plan is that you want a meadow, then which of the invasives do you actually want to remove, which are the important ones? It kind of directs you as to those specific ideas. And then you mentioned one place about you're going to monitor the health of the wetland. That's a pretty vague thing, and so how does that fit in? Like, what are you going to measure? What are you going to mean? Are you going by certain guidelines about the health of the wetland? So it's a great thing to put in your management plan, but the more specifics about what the health
If I can respond to a couple of those things. We originally, in the document before Wayne edited it, said that we would ask the conservation officer to come and look at the wetland. Since this is our first time for MC3 through this kind of process, we actually don't quite know how to do it. And so we're going to need some help from the city and from the Conservation Commission to, you know, get our act together. But the other thing is, we don't actually know what the invasives are either. I mean, we're coming into a situation where you, the Conservation Commission, and OPD, you've been managing this land for 10 years, and there was never a complete inventory done, as there should have been when the CR was executed. And so I feel as if we need to have some slack cut for us here.
Well, I'm providing constructive criticism. I'm not saying, oh, you didn't come to us with some specifics and you needed to do that. This is a learning process where, you know, everyone's learning about this, and I think it's a great opportunity for learning. And so, yeah, I mean, I love this because it's you're in charge of conservation of this little piece of property, and so you can help figure it out.
But
propose, and with discussions with us or with other experts, bring them in as you know, have a walk and discuss.
And I can forward some information to you about some of the research I did about the weed that was moving
In terms of actually finishing this document to your satisfaction, though, I think it would be really helpful if you would forward specific language changes to Jane. Because
they're sort of specific, and they're also general. And this is a working document.
Yeah.
And so those are the two things. So how does the invasive plan fit in with, you know, with your overall goal?
It may be that step one of the invasive plan is doing inventory.
That's a great management plan. Out and in 1 year, a couple of years, over a course of a couple of years, identify what the species are that you want to have there, perhaps, and which ones do you think are prohibiting the maintenance of this conservation land, and then what is the health of the wetland mean?
So that doesn't have to all be done.
So we're saying this is where we're approving this concept of the management plan, and part of it is figuring out how you actually implement the plan.
And I can work with you on plants that are in the forest garden that could be expansive or dispersive, which is the terms I use instead of invasive.
That'd be great.
And that might be.
So there was a motion.
It was the same way. I mean, they didn't tackle the old orchard until they were well into the management process. So some things are going to change, or some ideas are going to change, or you're going to decide that perhaps this area should be open and will allow the trees to remain here after you get working with the property. And it's a simple come to us and either update the management plan or give us some written documentation as to what you're going to do.
So there was a motion to affirm the sense that this is a good document to be basis for the next step. Tim provided a couple of suggestions for ways in which it can be improved prior to that next step or as part of that next step. Any further discussion on that motion? All in favor?
How about a second?
Second.
Or was it? That was not a second. That was just an additional input. Okay. So yes, we need a second.
Second.
All right. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? So it is officially a good document, and with a couple of missing pieces in the next iteration, and that will bring us very close to ready to go with the MOU.
Could we just, for the record, have the name of the new commissioner?
Ms. Cynthia White. Welcome. Thank you. Thank you. Be happy to share my background with you at any point.
First meeting.
Daniel. Could I?
for a moment. I want to thank you all for, I have not read the document, but so far it sounds like a really good working document, and I appreciate your taking that leap to retain much of the forest garden. I would be happy to consolidate more some of those lobes that go off in different directions, for example, along the east side of Jim and Dora's property. Some of those plants could be brought into beds.
Mm-hmm.
Since
this is an offer for help rather than a
yeah.
That's whether
all right.
What you want to offer and whether they want to take you up on it, that's outside of the
okay.